CQC is medium-sized company, about 80 people now, mostly based in London and in Cambridge. So we work with lots of tech companies, we work with government labs, funding agencies, and some customers in various industries. So JSR Corporation are a chemical firm. So what do we actually do at CQC? Various things. So in our different places, so in one of our London offices, we do mostly machine learning. So one of these things is a product called Arrow, which is for machine learning in the finance industry. This is not quantum and therefore totally boring. We also do some stuff for quantum machine learning, which looks kind of like this, where we have some parameterized quantum circuit and we try to get it to reproduce some desired distribution by using classical optimization of the parameters which are in this circuit. But I'm not going to say too much about that. In our other London slash pretend London location, we are doing mostly security products. So there's a thing called Iron Bridge, which is effectively a Bell experiment in a box. So this is not really very much to do with category theory, but if you like quantum foundations, it's pretty cool. And in Cambridge, this is where I work, we do mostly two things, quantum chemistry and the quantum compiler. But we have also new natural language processing, which we're based in Oxford, and Bob will tell you a bit more about that later. Okay, so what do I actually want to talk about today? Not chemistry, but this is the name of the chemistry software. You can ask me about it more later if you want. But instead, this thing called Tiqit, which is a language and platform agnostic retargetable compiler for NISC devices. Sorry, lawyers made me do that. You can get Tiqit for free. If you use Python, you can just type pip install pytiqit and you will have it. Right, so I'll now try to explain some of these words. First of all, it's a compiler. So it's language agnostic, meaning there are different programming languages you can feed into it and it will accept them. And there are different quantum computers which it can generate code for. So in particular, let's say this language, Quill, is made by the Rigetti company, but if you would like to run it on an IBM machine, then Tiqit can do that for you. Right. So language agnostic, retargetable. So we say it's a compiler. So what does that effectively mean for a quantum computer? So we have some language which you can understand, and we do our stuff, and out comes a quantum circuit. So for the benefit of people who are not quantum computing, I will explain a little bit what I mean about that. So there's lots of like cool category theory we could do on the programming language side, but we're just going to not do that. I just say that's all Python, right? That's fine. So this is a picture of a quantum circuit. I think you can probably guess what's going on here. Some data comes in on the left. The boxes are kind of operations that do stuff. Results come out the right. Or the definition I would prefer to use for this audience is that a quantum circuit family is a prop which is freely generated by some set of gates and which is equipped with a strict monoidal functor into the category of finite dimensional Hilbert spaces. Is that okay with everyone, or should I explain some of these words? Okay, grand. So the other constraints that we have is that I want the generating object to be sent to C2, which we call the qubits. So the wires of our circuit are qubits. And we call the circuit family universal if the special unitary group is included in the appropriate width or in the appropriate Hom set. Okay, so we have to do a little bit more than just talk about generating circuits, even this very abstract definition, because this actually has to run on a quantum computer. And this brings me to the other undefined word in my title. So NISC is an acronym for noisy intermediate scale quantum. That means not very many qubits and they suck. So in a very specific number of ways. So we have quite a small amount of working space, so less than 100 qubits, which means that certain algorithms are not interesting. So Shor's factoring algorithm, you cannot do in 100 qubits. Right? This is also too small for error correction, so we have to live with the errors, which is what the noisy part is about. But on the other plus side, we can do universal gates, so we don't need to worry about generating very expensive error corrected fault tolerant operations. So it says here short coherence times. This basically means that my qubits, my quantum data, has a lifetime which is finite, very, 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 very finite, which means that my program has to be extremely short, otherwise I'm going to have garbage as the output. So as people who are making compilers, this makes us very focused on optimizing the circuits that we generate. A lot of these machines have other limitations, such as not every qubit can talk to all of the others, and there's a variation in the quality of the operations across the device. And I will come back to that in a minute. So here's a picture of one such device. They do exist. So this is one of IBM's machines. It used to be publicly available, but it's recently been retired. It has 16 qubits, as you can see in this diagram, and the edges in the diagram indicate that these qubits can actually talk to each other. Physically, it's a piece of aluminium that looks like this, which is cooled down to near enough zero Kelvin and bombarded with microwaves. So what are the operations that machine can do? On the right-hand side are the software-defined operations. So some one-qubit gates and a two-qubit gate. But actually, in terms of microwaves, they're actually more complicated things, which are kind of sketched on the left-hand side there. Right-hand side for you. So the two-qubit gate that I mentioned is called CNOT. One of the limitations of this machine is I can only apply CNOTs between pairs of qubits which are adjacent in this graph. And it's slightly more annoying than that because CNOT is not a symmetric operation, so I have to apply it actually in the orientation suggested by these arrows. So I can't just run any old thing on this computer. I'm going to come back to that in a bit. Yes, and just to elaborate on something I mentioned earlier, the numbers T1 and T2 refer to different decay modes of the qubits. So you can see here, T1, which is until I've got nothing left, could be 100 microseconds on this qubit, but on its neighbor only 28 microseconds. So you really have to get into the details here. So in practice, this means, in theory, on average, this machine can do a circuit of around 66 gates deep before your data starts dying. In practice, it's actually worse, but that's beside the point. So, having introduced the context, I want to touch on three areas where category theory could be helpful with problems of trying to use these machines for something that you might actually care about. I'm going to start off by talking about circuits, and hopefully I won't run out of time before I can talk about the other two. So this is the picture of the circuit I showed earlier. And so, as I mentioned at the beginning, we think of it as a prop. So I could think of it as a prop being generated by these generators, six gates. One of them on two qubits and all the rest on one. Since I'm talking about a prop, the second P is permutations, so I implicitly have the swap map here as well. All right, and then I give my interpretation functor just by assigning a matrix to all these generators, and everything else goes through by the usual structure of a strict monoidal category. Okay. But as we know, these matrices are not telling the whole story. So in practice, although these two circuits denote the same matrix, their behavior will be really different because of noise and other issues. So what we do when we are doing circuit optimization, and I mean optimization in the usual program optimization sense, not hill climbing, is we try to pick some metric, some intentional property of this circuit which we care about, and replace extensionally equal things which have, with equivalents which have better intentional properties. And this is inevitably done by having an equational theory of this prop and doing some kind of rewriting. So here's a very simple example. We can use these directed equations as rewrite rules to reduce circuits which are inefficient into circuits which are more efficient. This is a particularly silly and minimal example, but at least has the merit of being terminating. So I can think of this as being a syntactically presented prop. I have my generator sigma with the gates and my set of equations with these rewrite rules, and I'll just represent this internally in the compiler as a kind of a string diagram and do double pushout rewriting to transform circuits. All right. So this usual kind of Nielsen and Chuang style diagrams that you find in the quantum computing literature are not the only kind of circuit we can have. And so the underlying mathematics here is monoidal categories. We're using rewriting. And if I want to change from one set of gates to another, which I need to do if I want to run on different computers, then I will use strict monoidal functors to achieve that. Okay. But by changing the category of circuits I live in, I'm also changing the equational theory that goes with it. In particular, I could choose the ZX calculus as a family of circuits. It's permitted by my definition. If you haven't seen this before, you will hear more about it tomorrow. But that's the equational theory of it. It's not confluent or terminating, but it's based on the theory of Hopf algebras, which means that it's which means that it has a lot of algebraic structure we can call on, much more than the usual circuit notations. Okay, so we've used this recently for our chemistry programs. So we've defined this slightly different string diagrammatic notation based on the ZX calculus, made some derived rules. There looks like a lot of them, but they're all basically commutation rules. And then with a bit of cunning, you can use this to simplify the circuits that you get. So I'm not going to show any details here, but this column is a list of simulations of chemical systems, number of gates in the circuit, depth of the circuit, and these are comparisons with other circuit optimizers. And using this categorically inspired technique in ZX calculus, we are having by far the biggest depth reductions compared to the competition. So it's nice to use category theory for things which make you win, and this is very pleasing. So I kind of touched on this a minute ago, but these circuit families themselves are props, but I have a two category of different kinds of circuit diagrams. It's very easy to define these translations between them as functors. And if we're talking about universal circuit families, which are the interesting kind, then these kinds of translations will be relatively easy to define in all cases. But an interesting thing which we start to get involved in is try and have different representations of the program at the same time. So I can commingle the translation and the optimization, which means I'm kind of thinking about composite props, right? So if I just stick together two different circuit families, I can form this co-product, but it's kind of boring because I can't really do anything with it. So an interesting topic for categorical investigation, notwithstanding Dan's negative results yesterday, is to look at distributive laws of props in the case where the prop is an interesting circuit family. Okay, and there's been some work on this, which has been kind of exploited in some of the ZX calculus-based techniques developed by John van der Wettering and Alex Kissinger. How am I doing for time? Right. I started quite late. Right, I'm going to go fast. Right. So remember this. This is our circuit. Here is one qubit, and you can see that it's talking to the other four qubits in the circuit, right? But my machine doesn't have any degree four vertex, so I can't run that circuit on this machine. So the obvious solution is to insert some swaps to shift the states of the qubits around into the program. So as a this is some kind of combinatorial optimization problem. It's NP hard. It's kind of nasty. So we've got a good heuristic solution. Exact solutions are too expensive. But if I am not allowed to swap things, then I'm not really working in a prop anymore, right? I have to work in a pro. I can't even express the routing problem in the theory of props. So we could then generalize the idea of circuits to planar strain diagrams and then try to work out what's DPO rewriting in the context of plane graphs rather than arbitrary graphs. But that is kind of only the beginning of the problem. So if I think about the IBM machine, it's not actually a plane, right? It's this complicated shape down here. So you can kind of imagine that graph extruded in time. I can see the diagram that I actually want to work on, the surface I actually want to work on, is this weird cardboard boxy shaped thing. And so ideally, if I've gone to the effort of solving that hard routing problem, getting some version of my program that can run, I might want to do more optimization, which effectively means I want to be doing, again, double push-out rewriting, but on some complicated surface like this, so I could draw my circuit onto this weird shaped thing. I guess that's almost possible to understand, but you can see these red lines are the operations of the circuit on the many surfaces of this diagram. And it can actually be more interesting because some architectures can do more than just two qubit gates. So in fact, you're doing some kind of rewriting on some kind of simplicial complex rather than just a plane. So I'll stop with that, I think. I'm just going to skip this. I just want to mention one thing that we're working on in the immediate future to get rid of Python, or to augment Python, is we've just got a grant to develop a new linear dependently typed language for quantum computers. So we will be hiring someone for this project later this year. If you might be interested, let me know. Thank you. I don't know anything about Idris 2, I only know a little bit about Idris 1.
It's probably interesting to have a look at it. So mm-hmm. It has built-in linear types and dependently typed, and it might be. It compiles to scheme as well, so it's another nice.
Yeah, cool. So Conor McBride's working on that project as well.
Advantage of self-care is you can impose on yourself a task of 2 minutes, which you can't do on somebody else.
Okay.
I'm going to just speak for 2 minutes. I'm going to stick to schedule and
share. I cannot record.
Okay. Well, it's not worth it. It's going to be so short that it's not worth it.